to get used to it, so and some of you just. We just really appreciate the effort everyone's made to come here. It's really just what I said earlier, I just can't believe you all made such an effort. It's just really for us, so that's really touching. So I've put a few words together. The thing with these things is that keep short as well, so I'll try. Now, as is custom, there will be a few toasts during my speech, so please charge your glasses if you haven't already, and try not to neck the whole one on the first toast, mentioning no names. So, if I'd like to start... I'd like to start by just again saying thank you so much for coming. You've all helped make today so special. We're genuinely touched by the effort you've made. So on behalf of my wife and I, thank you so much. Thank you so much for all your lovely cards, gifts, and well wishes as well. Sure, so you. I'd quickly like to thank all the staff here as well for their discreet help, work, and our treats and excellence, as well as their generous support both today and the leader. So thank you very much. Unfortunately, it's not been possible to have everyone we wanted to here today for various reasons. So with them in mind, please join me in our first toast to Absent Family and Friends. To Absent Family and Friends. Now, we have a fair few thank yous to the people who helped today possible, make today possible. Firstly, Roger and Linda. I'd like to say a personal thank you for welcoming me into your family with open arms. And for helping make Kaya the woman she is today. Roger, I'm sure you never envisaged your daughter marrying a kayaker. I can only congratulate you. Linda, you look beautiful today. I'm going to say the stereotypical, I can see my wife gets a good look to run. It's true, you do look lovely. I'd also personally like to thank you for giving Kaya the push to give me a chance 4 years ago when I was courting her. You must have known then that I was going to be your future son-in-law. Also, thank you for grooming Charlie so brilliantly. He always looks fantastic at the session today. So thank you. On behalf of my wife and I, we'd like to thank you for all the support you've given us through our relationship, as well as in helping to create this fantastic day. So please accept a small token for our appreciation. On that note, I'd like to make a toast loving parents. To loving parents. Right, to the bridesmaids. I'm sure everyone will agree just how elegant you all look today. Rachel, thank you for playing still back. Glad you're introducing me to Hyde all those years ago. It takes a special kind of genius to know our students are meant for each other. Thank you for being the voice of calm and reason for Heidi, and for bringing us in the past debates. We know we're right. You guys have been friends since you were at school. I know how hard it must be to let a complete stranger into your circle, but you've made me feel so welcome. I'm eternally grateful for that, for the kindness, support, and friendship you give to Heidi, especially in this day, so thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please raise your glass and toast to the bridesmaids. Katie and Pat, you have to sit far enough. A man could live 1,000 lives and never have a sister who mentioned that to you, and I have two of you. You've led me into mischief and kept me out of it. You've made me laugh, you've made me cry, you've comforted me, and you've told me to man up and get on with it. We've shared far too much dimension, but what I'm most grateful for is that you taught me how to honour and respect a lady and treat her properly. Sisters, that little bit of childhood that can never be lost. Katie and Claire. Talking of childhood, that leads me on to my next thank you. Billy and Harry. My little flower girl and page boy. Minnie, you look so pretty, just like a princess. And Harry, you look very, very smart. I'm so impressed with the effort you put into tennis. You did a really good job. Great job taking your sister down the aisle. You rocked it. So thank you both very much. Nearly 4 years ago, when I was working in South Road with Rachel, I had a mysterious friend request on Facebook. Yes, that is how it happens these days. Naturally, I was suspicious, as it's not every day a beautiful girl introduces herself out of blue. But I saw she was friends with Rachel, so I accepted her request. And we got chatting. You missed a few, mate. Too late. Several weeks later, I was out sampling the delights of Plymouth with Nick. We bumped into Rachel and Heidi. Naturally, we said hello, and like any good wingman, Nick struck up a conversation with Rachel's friend. So much so that I couldn't get a word in edgeways. After some time, several drinks, and a dance off with a midget in Annabelle's, it was time to go home. I still hadn't managed to talk to Heidi. I thought I'd missed my chance. And things went from bad to worse when she heard me tell a taxi driver I lived in Stonehouse. Miraculously, she agreed to go for a drink with me another time, and I'd love to say it all went brilliantly from there on, but it turns out I'm really terrible at dates. So after walking down the hall in the pitch black, pouring hot water all over her, setting her on fire, and nearly drowning her and put her off, I knew I had a keeper. Incredibly, in spite of all my shortcomings, Heidi not only stayed with me, but also agreed to marry me. I count myself the luckiest man alive, because today I not only married a beautiful, intelligent, funny and caring woman, I also married my best friend. You don't marry a person you can live with, you marry the person you can't live without. Did I mention she can cook? Now I'd like to take some of the credit for putting together such an amazing day for everyone that I desire. You've done an incredible job organising our wedding. But I love you with all my heart, and I can't wait to start the next year of our amazing adventure together. So please can I ask everyone to raise your glasses to the most important toast I'm ever likely to make, to the woman that made this all possible, my beautiful wife, Heidi. And last but not least, the best man. Thanks. I hope Simon is more nervous about his own speech than what I'm going to say about it. Paul's getting married next year and I'm his best man, so I'm pretty sure. Paul first met his princess. When we first met, we did have a pink penguin. We will have to ask him about that later. He's very forthcoming about it. He loves talking about it. Yeah, it's just changing this. Thanks for being a great friend over the last 10 years and providing me with endless amounts of laughter. I met Paul, Penguin Taylor and all, on our first season working for Mark Warner in Sardinia, and we quickly became inseparable. In fact, at the end of the season, we won the Barbie and Ken Award for the best couple. We got photo evidence as well. He was Barbie, by the way. I taught him to drink, and he taught me to windsurf, and passed on his excellent taste in Mercedes vans. Paul's been an absolute rock for me over the years, and I'd often wondered why he puts up with me. I still don't know, but I will be forever in his debt. Thank you for organising a brilliant stag do and making sure I got home from it in one piece. To say that was the final toast of my speech, to the best man. And finally, before I hand it over to Paul, he's overcome some real obstacles to be here today. He's going to make a bigger, even bigger fool of me than I already have, but you need to be aware that he strangely and unfortunately suffers from a rare medical condition known as dit spinning. More commonly known as why let the truth get away has been a good story. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. I'm not quite sure I'm going to follow that. Unfortunately, I have to wipe a few bits of my speech out now. So John asked me to be his best man last year. I was very, very pleased. He also said shortly afterwards, you don't have to make a speech. Well, no, I'll do it. That'd be great. Wasn't the best decision I've ever made. So as the best man, that really got me thinking, who is the best man? I've got to look back through our friendship and try and work it out. Started back in 2005, when we were on a bus going from north of Sardinia all the way down to the south. I was knackered and I wasn't the only one. We were up in some ungodly hour with a 6 a.m. flight out of Stansted, so patience really wasn't my strong point at the time. Most of us were quiet and trying to sleep a long journey away, however there's always one. Well, in this case there were two. I remember there were two guys who would not stop talking the whole way down. Not just quietly muttering to each other, but rashly and boomily declaring dudes and awesomes and all sorts of rubbish like that. I remember thinking at the time, really hoping I don't spend any more time with these people, I'm going to end up throttling them. Eventually we pulled up to the hotel and we wound up to our designated rooms, home for the next 6 months. My heart sank. It was gobby setting up camp in my room. Well, needless to say, I proved myself quite wrong there, because here I am 10 years later. And I think it's safe to say, probably wasn't the best man on that occasion. From there, our friendship blossomed. He taught me to sail, I taught him to windsurf. He taught me to surf. I provided with him endless opportunities to take photographs of windsurfers. He taught me to drink. I don't really remember much more of that season, thanks very much. I must say, he put an awful lot of effort into teaching me to drink. Part of me thinks he enjoyed the training. I think in this instance, his care and commitment to that cause really did make him the best man in that one. After Sardinia, we came back to Old Blighty. John went off and worked in Egypt for a few months. I went to work in a petrol station. 2-0 to John. He continued to a few seasons in Portugal and Greece. I progressed by the lorries. 3-0 to John. They're going to stop counting there, Jake. I like to think our friendship was galvanised by our mutual love of the sea, but I know that more than one of our exes thinks of mutual love of each other. We were pretty close, I think it's safe to say. I'm surprised not to see our Barbie and Ken photograph here. There was this one time at Damien when we'd been out windsurfing and I bashed my arm pretty badly, and John, being the caring soul I alluded to earlier, was helping me get him dressed out of my wetsuit. So we're still at the back of my van, he's helping me get it all off, and I just sort of turned around to look behind me, and this old lady sat in the car. The look she gave us, I shall never forget. They get everywhere. We didn't help ourselves, did we? It seems like we spent the next 10 years meeting up basically whenever it was windy and waving. I'd give him a call, usually on a Thursday night, saying, "David, this weekend?" And the answer back then was invariably yes. Happier times, eh? I don't know what's changed. I remember vividly the first time we brought Heidi up to see us. She recognised a particularly obscure intern I had from a TV show watching, and I was sold there and then. I thought John was too. We went on a bike ride, and halfway through, he decided to push her off the bike, didn't she? Yeah. It was all right. It was all right though. The sting net was brilliant for, didn't they?
Yeah. Sounds bad at things.
But despite that, she stayed with him all the same, and I'll be glad she did. But back to John. I was always very impressed with his commitment to windsurfing. I think it's fair to say that originally, you weren't that good, were you? We'd go out when it was horrendous, blowing 60 knots and head-wide waves, and I'd be sat there thinking, flipping heck, that's a bit much. But no, John would be straight out there, going large, all that sort of stuff. He spent the majority of his time being washed about by the waves. I think he defined the term wind swimming in that
one. Yes.
But he always come back in with a big smile on his face. Epic. Commitment actually sums John up pretty well. Whether it's surfing, windsurfing, snowboarding, sailing, teaching me to drink, drinking for his own training, kayaking, photography, or his career, it's always 100%. That's also true of his relationships with Heidi. That's why I know he'll put 100% into his marriage, and I'm sure they're going to have a long and happy life together. I originally thought that's where I'd finish my speech, and I realised I haven't taken the time to say anything about what you mean to me. You're my best friend I could ask for, and to me, you've always been my best man. I know we don't see as much of each other these days as we should do, but when we do get up, it's just like 10 years ago, when we were working, on a beach in Sardinia. So here's to you and your beautiful wife, the bride and groom.
Bride and groom.
That's it. Thank you very much.